Church, please stand and sing with us our first worship song for today. Take your seats this morning. Good morning. I'm going to light these candles. Good morning again, and welcome to worship at Grace United Methodist Church. We're glad that you are here. We especially welcome the Cook family. Always great to see you guys. Hello, good to see you here. We wanted to introduce ourselves to you if we've not had a chance to meet. So I'm one of the pastors here, and my name is Jessica.
I'm Kara, and I'm the Director of Youth and Missions here at Grace. And we wanted to offer you guys a chance to fill out a Paper Connect card, or if you look on this in the pews, there's a QR code that you can scan so you can connect with us today.
Yes, and today we are in our third Sunday of Advent. This Sunday is often associated with Mary, the mother of Jesus. You'll notice that we are lighting three candles today, and the third candle is our rose-colored candle, which represents the joy that Mary had. And today we're going to be doing a variation of a traditional type of lessons and carols. So you'll get to hear the story of Mary in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, and then also hear songs and sing songs that help bring that story alive. And so at this time, we want to invite our Advent scripture readers up here, and that is the Grandy family. And then Reagan will be reading one of our additional scriptures a little later in the service as well.
Thank you.
power, O God, with great might, come among us. And because we are sorely hindered by our sins, let your bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Tell those that are afraid to take heart, the Lord our God will come.
Would you please stand with me as we read the first scripture? Our first reading today comes from Luke 1, 26 through 33. In the sixth month, the angel of Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end."
Your baby.
At this time, we want to invite the children who are present to come forward. We're going to have our children's moment led by our Director of Children and Family Ministries, Miss Anna Burrell. So come on down and have a seat.
Hi. Oh, we have a lot of friends coming this morning. Good morning, friends. Good morning. Good morning, friends. I'm Miss Anna. Can you guys say good morning, Miss Anna?
Good morning, Miss Anna.
Ooh, how many of you are so excited that Christmas is in 1 week? Oh, me too. I am so excited. So I want to tell you guys about something that happened around Christmas 5 years ago. I was not feeling good. My tummy was hurting and I was tired all the time. And I went to the doctor. And the doctor said, I'm going to give you some medicine. Before we give you some medicine, we have to check your blood to make sure that you don't have a baby in your belly. And I said, okay, take the blood. I know I don't have any babies in my belly. That afternoon, my phone rang and the doctor called me. And guess what? There was a baby in my belly. That baby right there. That one right there. I got a phone call. And it shocked me. Now, Mary found out that she had a baby in her belly in a much more exciting way than a phone call on a Tuesday afternoon. She was visited by an angel. You knew that? Because you're so smart. Yeah. And if you were listening to what Miss Kara read in the scripture earlier, an angel visited Mary, and the angel said to Mary, you are blessed. Why would Mary be blessed? Maddie. Yes, because she was going to be the mother of Jesus. The angel says that the baby will be named Jesus. He will be a king like David. He will be holy and the Son of God, and his kingdom will have no end. Yes. That we're, spoiler alert, we'll get to that in just a minute. All right, so this angel appeared to Mary and told her, good news, you're having a baby. And this baby is going to be like a king, except his kingdom will have no end. Can you guys show me a surprised face? That's a great surprised face. So let's find out what happened next in our scripture. It's going to come up on the screen. Mary said to the angel, how can this be since I am a virgin? So Mary was saying that she was a young woman who wasn't married, and she was confused about that. Usually in the Bible, when people ask a question to an angel, the angel will give them a gift or a sign. And so here's what the angel said to her. The angel said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, guess what? The angel had more surprises in store for her. Your relative Elizabeth, who was an older lady, she was probably Miss Anna's age, right? No, she was older than that. But your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing is impossible with God. So the gift, the sign that God, the angel, was giving to Mary was one, he was telling her, there's another woman who has a miracle baby in her belly. And she could go to her to ask for help. When Miss Anna had babies in her belly, there were my grandmothers, my mother, my aunts, other women that had done this before. It was so nice to have someone who knew what I was going through, right? Do you guys have friends that can help you that have been through stuff before? You know, your moms, how many of you have moms and dads that have been like, well, when I was that age? Yeah, right? You have those helpers? So she knows that she's not alone. She's not alone, but she's still surprised because it seems impossible. But like it says, the angel says, nothing will be impossible with God. When God says something, it will get done. That's the promise to all of us, that when God says something, it will be done. So how do you think Mary was feeling? She was scared and nervous. Scared. She was scared. Well, guess what Mary said next? Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. So Mary was scared, but she said, okay, if this is what God wants me to do, I will do it. And then the angel departed from her. So we do not have pop-out church today, okay? Because Miss Anna's going to go set up for the birthday party for Jesus. Guess what? That's coming up, right? So that will be downstairs in the fellowship hall at 10 o'clock. But thank you guys so much. And go back to your parents. Bye.
Thank you, my parents.
Everything inside me cries for order. Everything inside me wants to hide. Is this shadow an angel or a warrior? If God is pleased with me, why am I so terrified? Someone tell me
Our scripture reading will be next. Miss Reagan Grandy will be reading for us, and I invite you to stand as you are able for the reading today.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. Listen for the word of the Lord. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him, from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in his thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lonely. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her for about 3 months and then returned home. This is the word of God for the people. Thanks be to God.
So good. You may be seated. So a big thank you to all of our leaders in worship today. Especially thank you to Kara and Anna, who kind of stepped in at the last minute to help me out here. Pastor Drew is not well, and so he's home recovering. And so we pray for him to be feeling better, and I am bringing his words to you today. This was a message that he wrote in preparation for today and was unable to be here because he is did not want to share his germs with everybody. But I'm going to share this on his behalf, and I will try to lower my voice a little bit so that you feel like you're hearing from Drew. Just kidding, I will not do that. So today's readings from the story of Mary started with the angel Gabriel announcing to Mary what was about to happen to her, with her, through her. But did you notice when it happened? It happened in the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Now in this last reading, we see Elizabeth, who we met last week. This older woman in the third trimester of her miraculous pregnancy is here reunited with her also pregnant, much younger cousin, Mary. In some sense, the gravity of what Mary heard the angel say to her only really sinks in when she hears her older cousin Elizabeth greet her, "Hail Mary, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus." As Elizabeth says it, Mary comes to believe it. And then, since they could use all the confirmation they could get, Elizabeth's baby John leaps in her womb, already signaling that the child that Mary is holding is the great I Am. Mary knew. But Elizabeth confirmed the news when she called her blessed. Now here, I must take a moment to brag about my own mother. Some of you have met her. Now again, this is Drew's mother, not my mother. Just in case, just to bring it back. I know. So Drew's mom, my mom, is a retired pastor who says she knew long before I did that I'd one day join the family business. My mom has always been an amazing pastor and a bit of a ministry entrepreneur. There are missions and ministries in Virginia thriving today whose origins have her fingerprints on them. The Potato Project, Harvest of Hope, Calling 21, and more. But one in particular is worth mentioning today. It's called the Elizabeth Project. She started it in response to what she and others saw as a too high rate of teenage pregnancy and infant mortality in the 80s and 90s. The project, going against the grain of the culture, did not judge young mothers. Far from it. The Elizabeth Project was designed to embrace them. It paired young mothers, who they called Marys, with older women called Elizabeths, so that for the duration of their pregnancy and the sleepless days and nights of early motherhood, these Marys would not be alone. Imagine my surprise when I arrived at Grace 5 years ago and read through your own church history in the Red Book. There's a lot of great stuff in there, but when I turned to page 124, I almost leapt out of my chair. There it reads, in April 1992, the Genesis Circle of the Grace United Methodist Women launched a chapter of the Elizabeth Project. Grace was the first church in Northern Virginia to participate, working to offer a gracious biblical means of responding to pregnant teens and infant mortality. The friendships this ministry developed had life-changing and even life-saving impacts. I share this with you first because I'm incredibly proud of my mother's life of ministry. And second, because I am incredibly proud, moved to serve a church like Grace. But third, and even more than the first two, I share this story with you because it illustrates how the story we have read and sung today, a story we tell every year around this time, has, by the grace of God, become our story. It was only after Mary heard Elizabeth's blessing that she could see her own life and the life growing within her as a blessing. And then together, they gave birth to the story of God made flesh. We have these stories and we tell them because this is what God does. Repeatedly in the Old Testament and decisively here in the New Testament, we see a God who is writing us into God's own story. So much of our lives are lived under the pressure to be the authors of our own story, to do whatever it takes to make sure our character comes out on top. To this, the Bible says a resounding no. We, together, are mere creatures, vessels, characters in God's story. And Mary, even here in the earliest weeks of Christ's first advent, in no small part because she had Elizabeth by her side, she sees this story, her story, as part of God's story. Notice the song she sings, this Magnificat. It is not a song that is chiefly about her. It is a song about God, what God is doing. And she knows, in fact, what God has already done, already set in motion. Elizabeth and Mary together declare that because of what the angel has told them, they know now beyond their own doubts that this story, that every story has not just a happy ending, but a blessed one. Mary knows that what Christ will show, that God looks not with judgment, but with favor on the lowly, that his mercy is for all children from generation to generation, that the future of all humankind is to be scattered, of our pride is to be scattered, the future of all human power torn down, but the future of the downtrodden and forgotten is to be lifted up. The hungry will be filled and the overfull will be emptied. Mary knows, and Elizabeth's love confirms it, that in her womb and by her labor, God is giving birth to a new creation, that the world is being, has been, and will be turned from sin to forgiveness, from shame to glory, and from death to life. And so, in the words of Elizabeth and the angel Gabriel and our mother church in every generation since, I say, blessed be Mary, full of grace, and blessed be the fruit of her womb, Jesus, and blessed be each of you who by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection have been given a place in this story and the hope of its joyful end. Thanks be to God. At this time, we are entering into a time called Living Thanks. It is a time for you to reflect on what you have heard, to think about what this good news means for you. You're invited to come and pray at the altar. At this time, if you have Connect cards, you can drop them in one of the baskets up front or any offerings that you brought with you today. But this is a time and a space for you to connect with God. All are welcome.
Strong, help
Trusting in God's grace, our worship continues now with a time of prayer on behalf of the church and the world. As we pray, you are welcome to mention your own prayers aloud or in silence. Then when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you're invited to respond with the words, hear our prayer. Let's give it a try. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for this opportunity to come together and worship you. Father, be with those who are in pain and struggling during this season. Lift up each and every name that is said aloud and in silence. Help them to know that you are there in the good and in the bad. Together in peace, we pray to you, Lord God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, our enemies, and those who are alone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. Lord, in your mercy. For the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. Lord, in your mercy. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and those in need. Lord, in your mercy. For the peace and unity of your church, for all who proclaim the gospel, seek the truth, and serve you in this world. Lord, in your mercy. For the mission and ministry of Grace Church and the concerns of this congregation, Lord, in your mercy. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins and the sins of the whole world. Lord, in your mercy. Have mercy upon us, most loving God. In your compassion, forgive our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and uphold us by your Spirit that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord, who teaches us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hear the good news. The Lord is faithful and true, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. In the name of Jesus Christ, your prayers are heard and your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now would you please stand as you're able and join us in our final worship song, The Reign of Mercy. The rain of mercy never ceases.
That you are able to be with us on this third Sunday of Advent, and we want to share with you some ways that you can remain engaged with Grace in the days and weeks ahead, and so here are a few announcements.
Don't forget, there is a birthday party for Jesus after this service. Kids ages 3 through 5th grade can head down to the fellowship hall and meet with Miss Anna, and I heard that there are going to be maybe some cupcakes, so that's something to look forward to. Also, we will be having a Blue Christmas on Tuesday at 7 p.m. This can be a very painful and difficult season for those who have experienced recent loss or disruptions in their lives. And Blue Christmas worship offers us a time to acknowledge this and to come together in remembrance and hope. It will be live streamed and recorded. And the big event, Christmas Eve worship service. There will be one worship morning service at 11 a.m., and it will also be live streamed. We'll have a 4 p.m. family friendly with a pop-up pageant, 6 p.m. contemporary led by our wonderful Thrive music team, and it's also live streamed. At 8 p.m., there will be a festive in spirit with traditional music groups. 11 p.m. will be traditional candlelight with music starting at 10:30. And all services will include communion and candlelight silent night. And one other thing about our Christmas Eve service, overflow parking note. On Christmas Eve, we have a one-time parking permit to park in the bike lanes down Henley Road and outside of the church lot. And then other options will be Wellington Community Center, pool, or Giant Shopping Center. So we hope you'll join us.
All right, and we also wanted to let you know that on Christmas Eve, every year we take a special offering and to be given away in Jesus' name in order to make an impact in our community and the world. And so this year, we feel called to impact medical debt. And so we're working with an organization that's called RIP Medical Debt, And we will be making a gift that then this organization is able to multiply by 100. And they do this by buying up debt at reduced rates in order to cancel people's debts in groups. And so Grace has already pledged $10,000 out of our Caring and Sharing Fund. That will impact $1 million of debt. And your Christmas Eve offerings will also allow us to deepen that impact even further. And so we invite you to join us Christmas Eve and then plan on participating in this special offering. Then mark your calendars, because on January 5th, we are going to have an Epiphany party and burning of the greens. I don't know if you came last year, but it was a good time. It was a big fire. So leave your anxiety at home and bring your trees and your garland. And then also we have a staffing announcement. Is Kristen? Yeah, Kristen's in the back. She's waving. You can kind of look back and see Kristen. So the good news is she's not leaving. She's not leaving. Probably scared you guys. She's actually taking on a full-time position. And so her position will be expanding as the director of congregational life. And an email went out this week that has more information about what that entails. But please join us in celebrating Kristen. She is a blessing. Yeah, we're thrilled about that. So thank you. And now receive this benediction. Before I give you the benediction, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to put a mask on. I'm not going to shake your hands. I have a sick kid at home. I am coughing. I'm okay. But I don't want to get anybody a virus. So I'm just going to back up a little bit and wave at you so that everybody will know. Nobody will have to ask me, what's with the mask? Now you all know. But there's a lot of illness going around. And so just pray. Pray for people to feel better. And, you know, during the holidays, it's a hard time to be sick. So let's keep everyone in prayer. All right, receive now this benediction. May we all go from this place remembering the good news that the angel shared with Mary, that nothing is impossible with God. Amen.